Please welcome Ameet Ranadive and Allison. Thank you. Ameet, thank you.
Hi, Ameet. It's really good to have you. Ameet is the VP of Revenue Products at Twitter. That means he touches everything from the Twitter Ads API to video to website cards to the MOPUB mobile exchange, conversion tracking. I mean, it's a lot of stuff, so I feel like it's safe to say that if it has to do with monetization on Twitter, then you're involved in some way.
Yep.
So I thought you could just take a second to introduce yourself a little bit more and also explain where you fit in the org structure
sure.
at Twitter.
Yeah, so first of all, thank you so much for having me here. It's great to be here. I've been with Twitter for 4 years now. Twitter actually acquired our company where I was a co-founder. And so I've been an early member of the Twitter monetization team. Have really seen the Twitter ads platform from really its bare metal form. And our team, as you said, is responsible for all of the ad monetization products. So everything from the formats to the targeting, the measurement, the user interface for advertisers and the ads API. And I'm part of the product organization, so I work really closely with Josh McFarland, who some of you may know from Telepart. We acquired Telepart last year. And we report into Kevin Wheel, who some of you may also know. He's the senior vice president of product over all products at Twitter, both ads, business products, but then also the consumer products as well.
So I think that's very interesting, actually. You know, the business line and the engineering side, product and business really closely aligned.
Yeah, we work really closely with the sales team. So Adam Bain is our chief operating officer. And, formerly he was running all of sales and revenue for Twitter. And his team consists of folks that manage a number of different sales channels and geographies, also the commercialization team for MOPUB. And so we have a really tight partnership between the product engineering side as well as the sales side.
So the first thing I wanted to touch on is kind of a very broad question. It's really about the potential for revenue on Twitter,
mm-hmm.
because some investors are a little bit skeptical. There are also, I don't know, acquisition rumors that float around every so often, like yesterday with News Corp.
Mm-hmm.
And so I thought maybe you could just address Twitter's vision and maybe
yeah.
explain what other people don't seem to get about it.
Sure. Yeah. What we're really focused on for our advertisers is driving results at scale. And we think about that when we focus on results, there's two main priorities for us. One is around video and the other is around direct response. And the scale is really going to come from monetizing Twitter's total audience. So, we have 320 million monthly active users that are logged in, coming to Twitter directly on our website or on our mobile apps. But we're actually much bigger than 320 million monthly active users. Whenever I give this talk whenever I give a talk in front of a group, I often ask the audience, how many people are active users of Twitter, and ask for a show of hands. And typically, anywhere from 20 to 30% of the audience will raise their hand. But then ask another question, which is, how many people in the audience have seen or engaged with a tweet in the last month? And almost everyone in the audience raises their hand. And that's really the power of Twitter, that our reach extends beyond the 320 million monthly active users. We have, on a monthly basis, 500 million visitors coming to Twitter that are logged out. And we also have a number of users that see our tweets organically on third-party websites and apps. So, major news sites like CNN and the New York Times, sites like ESPN. And then we're also integrated now into Google Search. And so users see tweets in the search results. So all of this is really the total audience that we have available for our advertisers to reach. And that's one of our top priorities this year, is to make it easier for marketers to reach that audience.
So you mentioned direct response, which I want to get back to
yeah.
in a minute, but I also want to talk a little bit about Twitter and data,
yeah.
what consumer data you have access to
yeah.
and what that data set means for advertisers
yeah.
and how it's useful to them. And actually, as a corollary to that, what you don't have, some of the
yeah.
limitations.
Yeah. When we build our ad products, we're always very thoughtful about how we can, the data that we can use and balancing that with user experience and user privacy, because for us, user experience comes first, and we want to make sure that we continue to earn the trust of our users. That said, we do have a lot of data that we're able to leverage for on behalf of advertisers. I think one of the main assets is around cross-device identity. We've got hundreds of millions of users that are logged into Twitter across smartphone and desktop. And we've also now, with the addition of the Telepart team, we've got some of the work that they've been doing around building an identity network. So cross-device identity is one of the major data assets that we have. The other one is just around real-time live interest signals. So at any moment, like we're kind of the pulse of the planet, so we know what people are into right now, what they're engaged with right now. And that becomes another very powerful signal for marketers that they can use, for example, to reach users right in the moment around a major event. We have an event targeting product that enables marketers to do that. And then we've also got data on users' longer-term interests based on the accounts that they're following. And all of this data, we have this on, obviously, the logged-in users of Twitter, but we're also now extending that to our Twitter audience platform, where we're actually taking advertiser campaigns that run on Twitter and extending them off platform, starting with MoPub, but then soon moving on to other exchanges as well.
So what about the limitations?
Yeah, so I think from a limitation standpoint, you sort of have to think about data in terms of both depth and breadth. So the depth that we have is around the interest signals and those live signals. We are certainly looking at other ways of getting more, demographic information, because we don't actually collect that when users register. We do have ways of getting that, and a lot of our users do give us demographic information, but that's certainly an area that we're thinking a lot more about.
And is there a thought to integrating more of Twitter's data signal into some of the other offerings, like MoPub, for example, which it's not fully integrated just yet?
Yeah, so what we've been focused on is taking the data that we get from Twitter, the platform, and then bringing that to bear on MoPub. And we've been doing that through the Twitter audience platform primarily. So the way that works is we take all of our existing segmentation and targeting signals for Twitter owned and operated, and then we create lookalike models for users who we find in MoPub. And we've been testing this and running it for some time, and we see really consistent results between what we'd expect to see on Twitter owned and operated and then what we see within MoPub as well.
So you brought up Telepart a little bit earlier. That's a huge acquisition for Twitter. It was the largest, I think. It was like $533 million. So if you can address what's going on with Telepart specifically, because it's been a little bit quiet. Haven't heard that much about what you're doing with it. And then also, what are some of the challenges that are facing the industry in terms of direct response.
So we've been really pleased with having the Telepart team on board, and Josh McFarlane in particular and his team, they've been the experts in retargeting, cross-device retargeting and dynamic product ads for some time. And so we're working hard to integrate their technology into the Twitter ad stack, and also leveraging all their expertise around dynamic product ads and retargeting as well. So we're still kind of in the early phase of that integration, but we're looking to scale that up over the next year. Overall, we've been doing some tests and learning a lot from having them on board. Your second part of your question around the challenges for direct response, I think one of the biggest challenges is when you ask marketers if direct response for them, how's it going on mobile, many of them will tell you that direct response on mobile doesn't work for them. They'll just say it doesn't work. And we believe that direct response does work on mobile, and we're working hard to prove that. And part of the issue is that you've got, and I'm sure we've talked about this throughout today and yesterday, people are spending more time on multiple devices and within mobile and within mobile apps in particular, but all the conversions are still happening on desktop. And so, and all the legacy systems for measuring conversions can't really measure mobile in-app inventory. So we're really focused on solving this problem, and it's imperative that we do, because 90% of our users and our usage happens on mobile. And so some of the things that we're doing, we talked about that cross-device identity that we're bringing together. We're also investing a lot in personalization, and this is where Telepart comes into play with their expertise. So for example, we're doing some tests around dynamic product ads, where we can start to do things like when a user browses a product on desktop, we can serve them a very personalized ad on the smartphone based on the intent that they've expressed. And the last thing is that, you know, we're really focused on measurement. We think measurement is the key thing to really unlock direct response on mobile. The two things we're doing there, one is we've been working closely with third-party attribution partners. So DoubleClick is a good example of that, where we have a special integration with DoubleClick. We are feeding them our mobile in-app advertising impression data. And then a customer of DoubleClick can come to their interface, kind of see in one view all their different media platforms, including Twitter, and how that's driving conversions for them, including our mobile in-app inventory. And then, you know, the other thing that we've been doing is working on conversion lift studies, where we can basically run a lift study where we take a group of users, hold them back from seeing ads, measure the conversion performance of both the control group that's held back and the exposed group. And we've seen really good results from that, where on average, users that click on promoted tweets, they convert at a rate of 3.2 times the control group. So we're really excited about continuing to build out the measurement products and these personalization products across devices.
So a lot of that has to do with off-platform reach, but on Twitter's own platform, it feels like there might be just really deep inherent challenges around making an impact with advertising, just because of the way the platform works. It's a fast-scrolling environment.
Yeah.
So how do you handle that?
Yeah, that's a good question. You know, one of the perceptions among marketers has been that Twitter's a platform of 140 characters of text, and that's indeed, you know, where Twitter did start. But fast forward to today, and most of the ads that are running on Twitter are rich media. So we see a lot of video. We've seen a tremendous amount of video growth on Twitter, as well as cards. So, you know, these formats that really drive users to take an action, like click on a website link or install an app. And so the environment is definitely one where users are consuming a lot of content quickly. They're scrolling through their timeline. And what we're seeing is that with the addition of these new formats, they create stopping power, especially video. It creates this concept of stopping power so that a user will be going through their feed, but then they'll stop and they'll engage. And so you know, video is a big part of that because it's just this rich canvas for telling stories, engaging users. And so that's where we've seen a lot of success.
And who knows, 10,000 character tweets might be next.
we can't confirm that one. But.
Well, so MoPub was Twitter's first real foray into you know, programmatic, and you know, then Telepart came.
Yep.
So those are two really large acquisitions. And what are some, I guess, potential soft spots that still exist in Twitter's ad stack, or just holes that need to be filled next the next acquisition?
Yeah. I guess, you know, kind of behind that question is we're presuming that Twitter's going to have an independent third-party ad tech stack. And we often ask ourselves the question, what can we be doing that is, you know, really proprietary and unique and defensible? And we actually don't believe that the world needs yet another ad server. So we haven't found religion yet on this question. We're not actually contemplating at this point building, you know, standing up an independent third-party ad tech stack. What we are focused on is driving results for our clients, and you know, the two acquisitions that you mentioned, MoPub and Telepart, those were both done in service of specific problems that we're trying to solve for our clients. And so, you know, that's really been behind our strategy, is making sure that, like, whatever we're doing, it's in service of, you know, driving client results.
But that said, I guess players like Google, Facebook, AOL, they do have these third-party ad stacks, which they operate, you know, in addition to their core platforms. So, I mean, should Twitter anyway be kind of mentioned in that same, I guess, like pantheon, you know, as having a stack, or?
Well, we do have an ad tech stack. We're using it internally. You know, one of the things that I've, when you look at, you know, a company like Google, go back in time. The way that they started out was first focusing on their owned and operated ads products and their business and delivering the best results for their clients that they could. And then over time, you know, they built an ad network, and that was AdSense, which later became the Google Display Network. And then, you know, after that, years after that, was when they moved into, you know, providing the software that powers ad tech, and that was with the DoubleClick acquisition. And so, you know, over time, you know, we very well may go in that direction. But right now, our main focus is on building out our own and operated business and then extending those campaigns to the Twitter audience platform into MoPub and other supply sources.
And then touching on another part of the stack, there's the self-serve ad platform, you know, which maybe might not be the most user-friendly, you know, thing ever.
Yeah.
So how are you addressing that? How are you thinking about it? Are you thinking of evolving it or expanding it?
Yeah. Yeah, so you know, we have an intense focus on improving the user experience around our ads user interface. We have a number of clients that are coming to Twitter self-serve. So they actually are, you know, small, medium businesses that are coming and running these ad campaigns. And we've made a bunch of changes over the last year to make it easier for them to buy. The first is we introduced a product that we called objective-based campaigns, which removes some of the confusion around what type of ad formats should I be using, how should I be paying for this. And so that product, you know, really made it easy and seamless for our marketer to come in and say, I want to drive video views or app installs, or I want to drive website clicks. And then based on that, we would take them through a pretty straightforward flow to get them started. The other thing we've been working on is bringing ad campaign management to mobile. So now all of our advertisers are able to access campaign management capability on their smartphone. And we even have a very simplified product that's really geared towards the long tail of small businesses that we call Quick Promote. So that allows a small business to run campaigns directly from within the Twitter consumer app. So once they become an advertiser, they can see their analytics around their tweets, they can see how much organic reach they're getting, and then with a very simple click of a button, they can now promote that. So those are just some of the things that we're focused on to make the experience easier. The last thing I'll mention is that for power users, we introduced a product that we call Ads Editor, which makes it easy for someone running like thousands of campaigns at one time to be able to make changes in a very, you know, easy and low friction way.
Well, so we've been talking a lot about paid media basically the whole time, so which is understandable, but how does paid media fit in with earned, owned, you know, how are those things, what's the interplay, how are they working together, especially on Twitter?
Yeah, so we think of Twitter as being the best platform to bring together organic, earned, and paid in one place and really see this, this magnification of all these threes coming together. And it's really because Twitter is live, public, and conversational. So what that means is that organic content, the best organic content from brands, it can take on a life of its own. And we've seen cases where users will take videos from brands and just, you know, tweet those and retweet those out to their followers. And we want to make it really easy for brands to be able to take advantage of that fact that things are conversational, they're public, they spread very quickly. So for example, we introduced a product that we call Conversational Video. And the experience is the user sees an autoplay video show up in their timeline with a call to action to tweet that video out to their friends and followers with the hashtag from the brand. So then when they do that, we automatically compose a tweet for the user, include the video and the hashtag and the messaging. And then the user ends up fanning out that video to their followers. And in doing so, they're generating a bunch of earned media on behalf of the brand. And brands love this because they think of this earned media as a way to get effectively lower cost per view and lower CPMs. And so it creates this nice effect between organic, earned, and paid. And we're going to be doing much more of that moving forward.
Well, so what would be the right way for Twitter to keep growing its video ad volume? Because obviously video is really important for Twitter and what you were just talking about.
Yeah, video is definitely one of the biggest bets that the company's making this year and also last year. And if you look across Twitter, Vine, and Periscope, it's really, we've got the most compelling and fastest growing video platform. Just over the last 12 months, we have seen an increase in video views on Twitter, across Twitter, Vine, and Periscope of about 150x. So, between last year and this year, there are 150 times more videos being watched and video views happening. And we've done a lot of work on the product side to make that happen. One of the things was introducing autoplay video ads onto Twitter. We also recently just announced the integration of Periscope with Twitter, and so the experience there is a user can now come into their timeline and start seeing live broadcasts coming in from Periscope automatically playing on Twitter. So, and we're just really scratching the surface with what we can do. The native autoplay video format is kind of the flagship product. And we're investing a lot there. But we're also doing a couple things. One is around pre-roll video. So last year we announced the availability of what we call Amplify Open, which is a program where marketers can get paired dynamically with content publishers, premium publishers. So these are companies like Fox Sports and MTV and BuzzFeed that are bringing video content onto Twitter, and now we can dynamically match an advertiser with that content as a pre-roll ad. And then the final thing that we're doing around video is with promoted moments. So we announced this product last fall, and really this is a way for marketers to use video as a canvas for telling stories and going much more immersive with that. So in a promoted moment, the marketer is able to bring together a number of different video creatives. They could be vines, they could be, you know, native videos, and really use that to tell a story. So, you know, when Warner Brothers launched Creed last year, they used promoted moments as the way to do that, to bring their story to life.
So we have time, well, not exactly, we have like almost no time left, but one last question, you know, because our session is called Twitter Sees the Future, well, what does Twitter see in the future? What's the future for Twitter? What are you excited about? What kind of trends are you seeing?
Well, one of the trends that I'm particularly excited about is, you know, just the fact that users are now demanding that ads become more like content in the sense that they need to be high quality, like the content behind those ads need to be high quality. And so we're seeing a lot of brands invest more and more time in content creation, building teams in-house, partnering with agencies that really excel at creating content. And the other thing that we're seeing is that marketers are now partnering with influencers and really, you know, trying to tap into their creative talents. So when we acquired Niche Media last year, that became a way for us to you know, connect brands with some of the top creators that speak to the millennial audience. And so brands like HP or even Comcast are using that as a way to identify and partner with these influencers. And that whole trend is going to continue because users really, you know, they want to be engaged and entertained. They no longer want to be like, you know, basically bombarded with media messages. So we're pretty excited about that and looking forward to help you know, continue the work that we've been doing with Niche.
Awesome. Well, Ameet, thank you for being here. And I feel like the main takeaway is, you know, like, don't count Twitter out. There's a lot going on in 2016.
Absolutely.
So thanks for being
here.
Thank
you so much.
This way.